Hi folks, it's Pastor Trish. Welcome to August. It's, as you can tell, another one of those evenings when I'm out and about, but I'm stopped here for a few minutes to share with you Psalm 45. Now, sometimes you come across some scripture reading and you go, what do I do with this, right? Or what in the world does this mean? Or what is the point of this? That's Psalm 45, at least for me, at least for today. And so I'll see what you think about it. But Psalm 45 is the one we are on today, and it is a royal psalm. It was written for a wedding. Scholars think perhaps it was written and used at several weddings over time, that there probably could have been some modifications or things done to it. But a wedding between a king and his bride. And if it was used like over again, I was thinking as I was driving here for a little while, I was thinking almost like the wedding march, right? Or the trumpet voluntary. Those are processionals and recessionals that have been used in weddings for a long time, or how like Ave Maria or the Lord's Prayer, certain litanies. In this case, I was thinking of songs, but that get used. And so it is likely or possible that Psalm 45 was used that way, with written for one royal wedding and ended up being used for more than one. The question becomes, what do you do with it today, right? So that's why I was like, sometimes there's scripture and you're like, whoa, what do I do with it? There are a couple of things. One is, it can sometimes would have been thought of as a messianic psalm. So thinking about the coming of our king and what that might mean. And in modern times, it can also be looked at as a psalm that would speak to the church and Christ. And so you've often heard, or you probably have heard of the imagery, or read that imagery where it's a marriage between Christ and the church, right? We are the bride of Christ. And there's some sense in that when you think about the covenant of marriage, as it might relate to the covenant between God and humanity. So you could see some of that in the psalm as well. The psalm starts out with a brief introduction. Then it basically has words of praise to the groom, then words of praise and adoration to the bride, and then it ends again with just a brief, almost like a blessing. The other piece that I thought about, and so I'm just going to give you a few verses, I think, just give you a flavor for it. It's actually 17 verses altogether. I'm going to read you a few here and there, and I invite you, if you're interested, to go and read some more. But it starts and it says, my heart overflows with a goodly theme. I address my verses to the king, and my tongue is like the pen of a ready scribe. Here we go, right? And so then it starts out, you are the most handsome of men. Grace is poured upon your lips. Therefore, God has blessed you forever. Gird your sword on your thigh, O mighty one, in your glory and majesty. Goes on, and then, let's see, where was it? The verse 10, it addresses words to the bride then. Hear, O daughter, consider and incline your ear. Forget your people and your father's house, and the king will desire your beauty. Since he is your Lord, bow to him. The people of Tyre will seek your favor with gifts, the richest of the people with all kinds of wealth. And so, kind of words of adoration and wisdom to both the king and to the bride. The other piece, as I was thinking about this psalm, that is sticking with me for today, that I wanted to share with you, is it's a royal psalm, and it reminds me that there will again be a time of celebration. It's hard for me, at least, and I'm guessing for you as well, on days like the ones we're living through now, to think about celebrating, especially with large crowds, right? Being close together. We all know weddings and funerals and graduation receptions, everything has had to change because of COVID. But I think this psalm reminds me that this won't last forever. Steve and I were biking in Waseca yesterday for a while, and there were a couple houses we saw where they have a sign in their window, better days ahead. And that's what this psalm is reminding me of today. Better days ahead. Better days are ahead. We will again celebrate in the ways that this psalm talks about. We will again be celebrating our covenant, not just, I say, with God, but with one another. And so I'm going to cling to that hope, that understanding of the covenant God does have with us, that we have with God, and that better days indeed are ahead, because God has promised that to us. That's Psalm 45. One last thing, I am going to post a favorite song of mine that also speaks a little bit about this covenant that we have with God. I'm going to do it when I get home, though. So check back in a little while and hopefully enjoy the song that I'll post for you as well. Have a good evening, and we'll see you tomorrow.